My name's Sue Sisley. I'm a physician. I'm based in Arizona. I do research on whole plant cannabis, and that's how I got interested in this movement. This is the clinical trial that we're probably most well known for, though we have other research that we're embarking on now. But this is an FDA-approved study looking at whole plant cannabis in military veterans with PTSD. And we've been struggling. Many of you guys have been following our saga to get this underway. After being tossed out of the university system, we ended up with partnerships with Johns Hopkins, University of Pennsylvania, UC Denver. It was a great gift getting fired. So this is, as I told you, I'm based in Scottsdale. I do internal medicine and psychiatry. I actually see patients full time. I'm not a cannabis physician. I don't write cannabis certifications. I'm just interested in the research side. Let's see if we can get this. And I have been taking care, just so you know, I don't own interest in cannabis. I'm not, you know, part of the industry. I've never actually used cannabis personally. So that's why I wanted to just make that known. I take care of veterans now for 20 years. I've been managing the medical care of military vets, police, and fire who are all struggling with PTSD. And that's how I started to become aware of the problem that we really don't have very good treatments for PTSD. And a couple years ago, after years of struggle with my university, the U of A College of Medicine, at the IRB committee there had approved our study and then proceeded to terminate us. They felt that the optics of having veterans smoking weed on campus was very concerning to them. And so ultimately, we put us at odds with that administration, and they tossed us out. But luckily, it was a huge gift. You can see we had a lot of great people who stepped forward and condemned this. People like Andy Weil, many of you know him. He's been a huge thought leader in the area of alternative medicine, integrative medicine. He wrote an open letter to the media condemning. This was really powerful because he's a faculty member at my university. So he was he's a department chair of integrative medicine. So for him to condemn the president's decision was really powerful. And lots of docs stepped up because I think all of us in the medical community are very concerned about the fact that universities are afraid of conducting legitimate cannabis research. Even when it's federally approved, federally regulated, they still are running scared from this, and it's really harmful to our efforts to try to characterize this plant better and understand more about its therapeutic properties. But the best thing that happened from this is it drew a ton of worldwide media coverage after we got fired because, you know, scientists all over the country viewed this as a real attack on scientific freedom. Even, you know, climate scientists, all kinds of folks really empathized with our situation, and it helped shine a spotlight on the barriers to research and helped us create a lot of meaningful public policy reforms over the last 2 years since that happened that I think are going to open the doors to cannabis research for other scientists now who want to get involved. So this is a huge help. We went on to implement our own private institute, so now we're happily independent. We don't work with any universities or hospitals directly. We go through a private IRB system, and that's something to be aware of. Not all countries have that. You know, if you go to Israel, if you want to do human clinical trials, you can't do that unless you work with a university or a hospital. But in the US, we have a private institutional review board system. So that's really helpful if you can't find one of these other mainstream institutes to do this work. After getting terminated, we got a $2 million grant from the state of Colorado to study cannabis for PTSD. So this is the trial that we're embarking on now. And the reason why we're, I wanted to give you a glimpse of some of the other stuff that we're going to be studying in Colorado. So all of these projects are going to be underway over the next few years, and you're going to see published data in all of these areas, including, you know, cannabis for pediatric brain tumors, cannabis for inflammatory bowel disease. So this was really an incredible gift that the state of Colorado has done by investing in cannabis efficacy research. The reason we've been fighting so hard to do this study is because this would be the first and only randomized controlled trial in the world looking at cannabis for PTSD. This will be, you know, hopefully a definitive study that will help us answer this question, does cannabis work for PTSD? We have tons of data about cannabis for PTSD, but it more falls into the realm of sort of case series and observational studies, and we really need this kind of rigorous clinical trial work to help answer this. So after 7 years of struggle with the government, we finally got our DEA Schedule I license. This is what it looks like. This simple piece of paper took us so long to get through. Yeah, thank you guys. So it was great, because what happens now is this is what the scientists call the golden ticket. It allows you the privilege of purchasing cannabis from the federal government. So I was so excited. We finally got to order this cannabis. And then I see, you know, pictures from my colleagues of what their previous study drug has looked like. This is a picture from Ethan Rousseau, shot these for us. And this is unrolled cigarettes from NIDA. This is when our study drug finally arrived last month, and I thought it was gonna, you know, 4 kilos of cannabis from NIDA would come by armored truck or something like that. Here's the FedEx guy shows up, has no idea he's transporting cannabis. Here's what they look like. They're just little Ziploc bags from RTI, which is the company that stores this in their freezers. By the way, it shows up frozen. It's been in their locker for a few years, and we dumped it out just to weigh it. That's part of the DEA protocol, and it's basically a green talcum powder. It almost doesn't resemble cannabis. It was so disheartening to see that this is what we are forced to work with. If you want to do any kind of controlled trials in this country, you are required to purchase cannabis from the University of Mississippi, and this is the quality of the study drug. I have other pictures. I don't want to bore you with this, but I can tell you that it's really discouraging to see that this is one way the government can sabotage efficacy research in this country, because there's only one federally legal supply of cannabis for controlled trials, and that's it. So it doesn't barely look like cannabis. It doesn't smell like it. It's tough. And this is, we have 4 different strains that we purchase, 4 different varieties. I don't know if I have any, I'm not sure if I have any other pictures, but I can show you. I have a ton of other photos of this, and it's just astonishing. The DEA monopoly, they get $68 million to perpetuate this monopoly. And even though I know everybody heard about the DEA announcement recently, where the DEA finally said, you know, look, we understand that the study drug is suboptimal, and we're going to allow finally for other licensed growers. But sadly, that announcement wasn't accompanied by any timeline. So, and we all know that the DEA are experts in delay. So this could take years for them to finally approve another Schedule I grower, and in the meantime, we're going to be stuck, you know, still forced to use this study drug. So I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit more. I'm just going to jump ahead here and talk. I want to focus on PTSD. Let's see if I have that. There we go. So this is how I started to get involved, is my patients. These veterans started persuading me that they were getting benefit from cannabis. And this was, you know, about 10 years ago, they started disclosing to me that they seemed to be responding favorably to the plant. And I was highly skeptical. I just couldn't even embrace the idea of cannabis as a medicine at all. I'd been indoctrinated in a very conservative medical training. So I was very dismissive of their claims. They would tell me that, you know, it was helping them in all of these areas, And I was just highly judgmental, and I thought all these guys were just drug seeking. And so finally, it was became so compelling because all of the family members, you know, you get all this collateral history from spouses and kids who would say, you know, I got my dad back. And eventually, we just couldn't ignore it. So that's how we ended up embarking on this clinical trial. And I'll tell you, the other thing that finally woke me up was I'd lost a lot of my own patients to suicide. And I realized that, you know, just a few years after that, the VA came out with that statistic we all know about, the 22 a day. And it became clear that we have a true public health crisis in this country when it comes to this epidemic of veteran suicide. And here you can see the VA recently came out with revised data that shows, you know, that they claim it's down to 20 a day because of their, you know, immense efforts to educate the public about suicide prevention. But the truth is that we all know that this number is falsely low. If you think about in my own practice, all of the veterans that I've lost to suicide have never been labeled as suicide. It's always being labeled as an accident, just because it takes so much effort from the government. In order to label something a suicide, you have to go through an entire psychological autopsy. The coroner's office just doesn't have the resources to do that. And often it's not beneficial for the family either in terms of what death benefits they receive. So ultimately, if you think about all the suicides I've had in my own medical practice that have never been labeled suicide, and you can see why this number, why we're challenging the validity of this number. But it doesn't matter. This number is already a horrific number and should be viewed as a public health crisis by our government, but yet you don't see our government doing the kind of, you know, arduous work to try to uncover new treatments for this or try to really tackle this in a meaningful way. And I think that's what is, you know, a real tragedy here. So this is, not many of you probably don't realize that there's only two medications on the market to treat PTSD right now. So it's the only thing that actually has an FDA indication is Zoloft and Paxil. And for those of you who've ever been on those or know, have family on it, you know, they're really disappointing. They have, you know, minimal efficacy. They have tons of side effects, you know, sexual dysfunction, weight gain. So here these veterans are coming back home. They just want to reintegrate, and we end up making them fat and impotent and listless, and it's just so discouraging for them. And then we've gotten really lucky because the media has jumped on this, and they've realized, you know, we have the articles like this out of the New York Times talking about the fact that these meds that I'm giving patients are really no better than placebo in many cases. And they have these black box warnings on them, right? Every single one of these psych meds that I give to patients say, this may increase suicidal thinking. So here I'm giving a medicine that is known, well documented, for increasing suicidality to a vet who's already vulnerable to that. So I wanted to just give you a glimpse of some. We just got invited to Walter Reed Hospital last year to present about two, three hours of cannabis curriculum to their military docs, and tried to show them this because I thought it's really compelling how, I'll give you an example. When these two meds, Zoloft and Paxil, fail to work, I'm allowed to utilize all of the meds in these different classes. So all of these psych meds are fair game, even though they've never been tested for PTSD. Nobody faults me if I use any of these meds because they're all viewed by psychiatry community as legitimate choices. So you can see all these SSRIs, all of these other antidepressants from any of these other classes, all of the sleep meds, the, you know, Ambien, all of that stuff is reasonable. All of the benzodiazepines, all of the bipolar meds, you know, the lithiums, the Depakotes, all of this stuff, all of the antipsychotic medications, like, you know, the Haldols and the Risperdals and all of this stuff, Zyprexa. keep going. It just keeps going. This is even a partial list, you know? This isn't even the whole gamut. But you can see all of the benzos are fair game, too. The Valiums, the Ativans. So now you can get a sense of why these veterans feel so, you know, just so demoralized. They get put through the gauntlet of all of these different meds because when one, or, you know, one combination doesn't work, we just keep changing it up every couple months until we find that sort of magic regime that's going to cure them. And the fact is that we never find that. We may find, you know, some combination of meds that helps suppress some of their symptoms. But that's why so many of these veterans are turning to cannabis, because suddenly instead of being on 12 different medications, 12 to 15 meds for PTSD, which is typically what happens, right? Because they get put on, initially, they might get put on Zoloft and Ambien, and then they come back and they say they're still having panic attacks, and they get put on some Ativan, and then they get, they say they're, you know, seeing things at night, nightmares, and they get up on an antipsychotic. You see how quickly that will snowball. Over the course of a year, they can easily end up on, you know, 8 to 10 different meds. And so these guys end up feeling completely, you know, just like guinea pigs. And so here, suddenly they discover a plant that could, and in many cases has given them, for the first time in their life maybe, a good night's sleep. They finally slept soundly and woke up refreshed for the first time in years. Or they get a feeling of hope. You know, like finally they want to wake up in the morning, they want to live. So that's why, you know, studying cannabis for PTSD is so essential, because this is probably the opportunity to have even a single intervention like this plant, this very complex plant that could tackle the entire constellation of PTSD symptoms with one intervention is really exciting. So I wanted to just show you a couple other things. We all know here, we've become the prescription overdose capital of the planet here. The U.S. we're just pummeling these patients with pills, and they're stockpiling them and overdosing on them. But here you can see, in the case of our veterans, they have a 33% higher rate of prescription drug overdose. So, and I blame us in the medical profession, right? We're the ones who are pummeling these guys with these pills, giving them way more than they need, so they end up stockpiling them, and then during a moment of weakness in the middle of the night, they end up overdosing. So this is something, there's no question that cannabis is a much safer option than most of the very addictive meds that I give to these patients every day. So I think this study, well, let me talk about this. One of the most surprising things I've learned over the last couple of years is our veterans in Israel and Canada have not just complete legal access to lab-tested cannabis, but it's fully subsidized by their federal government. And that was a big shock because, you know, our government keeps saying that the data's not there. They don't think the data is sufficient enough to justify it. But yet here you have, you know, progressive governments. Israel is fully sponsoring the cost for their vets. And the fact is, you know, the country hasn't burned down. You know, Israeli veterans are getting relief. They're high functioning. Same thing with these Canadian veterans. These are, I'll show you a picture. This group is a nonprofit called Marijuana for Trauma. And these guys are doing a great job of reaching out to their fellow vets and teaching them about how cannabis is helping them. And that's our best hope, is this sort of peer mentoring. Until we can get the buy-in from the medical profession, our best chances is seeing veterans doing this sort of peer counseling effort. So this, I'm going to leave you guys with this, and I do want to take some questions if we have time, but this is a depiction from one of my patients illustrated his own experience where, you know, he's drowning in pills and pill bottles, and he finally discovers, in this case, a rolled marijuana cigarette and found it life-saving. And I think that's what I wanted to leave you with, this image, because I think it depicts what so many veterans describe, that they feel completely hopeless, and suddenly they discover this plant and it changes their life. And we're so lucky that we have now, you know, some opportunities to start to study it in a really meaningful way and help give them even more guidance on, you know, how to use this plant. But I think, let me see if I... Yeah, let me do this then. If I have time, I don't know if there are any questions out there about cannabis for PTSD. Anybody got anything? Yeah, go ahead. Okay.
Hi, I have a collective with 65 to 89 year olds, and the critical part of the microdosing, starting them off slow and building them up, because we're all processing the deliveries differently. And my concern with PTSD, because I have a couple of patients, and everything I've read, they're saying predominantly CBD. Now, my question goes back to you. How do you dose them? And is it just with smoking? And when you smoke, you're going to lose a lot of the entourage of the other cannabinoids. So I thought that you could address that for me, please.
That's a great question. In our study, which is not at all the gold standard, we selected smoking as the delivery method because this is an early phase trial, right? It's a phase 2 FDA trial. So in this phase, we really wanted to do a real world study and imitate what most of the veterans are doing day to day. And right now in this country, most vets still prefer smoking over vaping and other methods. But I think you have a very legitimate point in that we don't really understand what is being lost through smoking, and there is potential that, you know, some of this stuff is, you know, valuable molecules are getting burned off and maybe prematurely. So what we'd like to do with this study, we're going to be looking at 4 different strains of cannabis. One of them is a CBD-only arm. The other arm is a 1-to-1 ratio of CBD to THC. And so we're hoping to start to answer these questions. Is cannabis beneficial for PTSD? And if so, what strains or varieties of cannabis might be best? And maybe even which strain should be avoided? I'm sure there's folks who believe that, you know, high THC might be detrimental for PTSD. But then we have other data. There's some early data out of that ICRS convention where they showed that high THC might be the most beneficial. And we have there's an open label study looking at dronabinol. You guys heard of dronabinol, just synthetic THC, where they showed a 75% reduction in nightmares just using pure THC. So there's really a lot of interest in all of these different phenotypes, and which is the most optimal is something we don't know yet, but we're hoping this study will start to answer those questions. But I think probably right now people are sort of defaulting to the idea that a 1-to-1 ratio is the best. Having strains that are rich in CBD seems of high value, just with the kind of calming effect of the CBD, possibly buffering some of the negative side effects of THC. But we don't know. This is all part of... Oh, yeah. Sleep and pain, right.
So if I have a CBD lozenge, that's a little bit of THC, it's great for my anxiety.
But
it's great for my anxiety.
But it doesn't touch the pain. Yeah. It might help a little bit more with the stress
disease
tone.
However, I think that there's nothing, the only one that really works
with
is a higher dose of
pain. Yeah, she's saying that, you know, she believes in her case that high THC has been more beneficial for pain control. This is interesting. There's going to be some folks after they're going to talk about this subject, so I'll let them touch on it. But I think the data so far on high THC is pretty equivocal on whether it helps. That's why we desperately need more studies, because the anecdotal reports from folks are that high THC is essential for pain control, but the existing published literature doesn't support that clearly yet. So it's going to be really interesting. People think that CBD is where it's at for pain also, but that's not what the patient reports are. So we'll see. Once we get some really rigorous controlled trials, hopefully we'll be able to answer that. Anybody else got? Yeah, over there.
Yeah, sure. It's 2 years total. So what we do is with 76 patients, we enroll them in a staggered way over 2 years, probably, you know, 4 to 5 patients a month, spread out over 2 sites. So my partnership with Johns Hopkins enables us to enroll, you know, patients independently, which is very compelling to the FDA. They like to see data from 2 independently functioning sites. So we'll probably enroll, you know, 5 to 6 patients over both sites every month. And then by year 3, we should have all the data published and all in the public domain. Everything we do, we try to make sure the public has full. We're putting all of it out there, the good and the bad, unlike pharma, right, where I used to do clinical trials for pharma for years, and I remember that there were a lot of studies that never saw the light of day because they didn't make their study drug look favorable. But in this case, we're publishing it all, and we want to make sure people know that we don't have any agenda going in. We're not trying to make this drug look good. We're not part of the industry, so... anybody else got anything? Otherwise, I'll let you guys hear our next speaker. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Hi. Have you, by any chance, just out of curiosity, tested your federally supplied cannabis for heavy metals, pesticides, things like that?
I can't believe you asked that because we are just getting ready to publish the results of this. It's amazing that in this DEA monopoly that we were talking about earlier, the fact that there's only one federally legal supply of cannabis at the University of Mississippi, in 48 years that they've enjoyed this monopoly, not one time has a researcher or research team ever sought to do secondary testing on that cannabis. Partly because the DEA refuses to tell you, you're not allowed to just send it out to Steep Hill or SC Lab or one of these state licensed labs. You're not allowed to do it because what you have is a Schedule I, you know, a Schedule I licensed drug from NIDA. So you're not allowed. There's a chain of command where you have to send it only to another Schedule I license holder. Well, you can imagine that there are very few labs in this country that actually hold a Schedule I license, and the DEA refuses to disclose who those labs are. So what we've done over the last, we were committed though from the beginning, we always wanted to do secondary testing on this. And so we spent months cold calling labs all around the country asking them, do they have a Schedule I license? Some of them admitted they had it, but then didn't have any reference standards for cannabis, had no experience testing cannabis. So ultimately we did find one lab in Colorado, TEQ Industrial, which was there. I just heard them speak over at MJ Biz yesterday, and they, you know, it's really interesting because I'm not yet allowed to disclose the results, but I can tell you that it's very concerning, and there's a lot of discrepancies with their testing and what NIDA reported. One of the problems you have with federal government cannabis is they refuse to give you a drug master file. So when I do clinical trials on other drugs for pharma or whatever, you get an entire drug master file that gives you all the characteristics of the study drug. But with NIDA cannabis, they refuse to share that. So even though they're taking $68 million of taxpayer money every 5 years through this NIH grant, there's no transparency. So we have no idea what conditions the plant was grown under, what are the cannabinoid profiles, what are the terpene profiles. None of that is shared with us, and I think that's just an abomination. I think we all, as taxpayers, should be outraged by that. But when you see the results, we're right now, because of this, of the concerning lab results, we're in the process of conducting a third round of testing. And so we're hoping that we can then go back to NIDA and share this with them and explain. Hopefully we can create a sense of urgency now with the DEA about why we desperately need alternative sources for study drug, because what we received, I believe, as a physician, would be malpractice to give to a patient. So I refuse to distribute the study drug to patients until we fix this situation. So hopefully we'll be able to go public with this soon, and I think you'll be astounded. So anyway, oh yeah, I'm sorry.
How are your patients getting their drugs?
So right now the study is in hiatus because we're disputing the quality of the study.
Getting your drugs, how are they getting
oh, they're cannabis now? Well, that's interesting. So in order to be in the study, they have to wash off cannabis anyway before they start. So if they're already using, yeah, they would have to abstain for at least 2 weeks prior to starting. So we're trying to get a good mix of patients that are experienced with cannabis and then those that are totally naive, so we can kind of compare the data later and see how. We, right now, this is just a partnership with Johns Hopkins, so it's the doctors at Hopkins and our site at, in Arizona, but eventually, yeah, we're working on it. We're preparing a study right now on cannabis as a substitution therapy for opioid dependence, and that will definitely encompass other physicians from around the country to look at that. I think it's been incredible. I'm sure all of you have experience with patients who've been able to successfully come off opioids, you know, heroin, Suboxone, other drugs, using cannabis to help buffer opioid withdrawal. So I think we're all really curious to see that data. So anyway, anybody else? Yeah.
So do you think coming out with the results of when you find what they've already given you could actually set back the DEA from allowing us to do further testing on
That's a good question. I am not sure how they're going to react. I sense that they're scrambling right now because they're in a panic. One of the interesting things that they disclosed to us is they've never done mold testing in 48 years, and that just is, I think, astonishing to everyone who works with a state license. You all know how strict we are about mold counts. So there's a lot of negligence, I think, that needs to get exposed. You know, we need to let the sun shine in on this, and then we'll see how they do. It's possible. This is sort of the problem, though, the philosophical problem with monopolies in general, that they get apathetic. They don't have any competition, so they don't have to be as rigorous and as conscientious as the rest of us. So that's why it's so crucial that the DEA end this monopoly. So I think, if anything, shining a spotlight on it, hopefully will just put a ton of public pressure on them to do the right thing. That's what we're hoping. So yeah, sure.
Yeah. Are there other schools applying for it?
Yes. Yeah. So that was what was exciting, was when the DEA made that announcement, there were at least 6 applications that appeared at the doorstep of the DEA within the first month. But the DEA, if you read those articles, they kept announcing that they hadn't received any apps. And it just shows you how complex that organization is, because they weren't even aware that one, you know, office had received these apps, and the PR director there was saying they hadn't received any. But the fact is, right now, this is about, we're about 2 months out from their initial announcement, and I think they've received about 24 applications. So question is, when will they process it? How long? I'm working with a team now in Hawaii. The Hawaii Agriculture Research Center has applied for this, and they're a very skilled, you know, precision agriculture. They don't have anything to do. You can't apply for a DEA Schedule I license if you're already breaking federal law. So if you're already a state license holder that's growing cannabis, you wouldn't be eligible. But many teams are creating a sort of, how do you call it, like third-party holding companies to be able to apply. And I think we're going to see some great people in the pipeline trying to participate. It's not a very lucrative business model, because you can only sell to researchers, and you can only sell at cost. So you're really doing it because you care about science and you want to, and maybe there's some long-term pharma play down the road, where if you're already in the business of growing standardized cannabis for research, that pharma, you know, some pharma company might buy you up later. But right now, I will tell you, there's some great groups that are getting in. This Hawaii group has had their application returned 3 times because the DEA said, this box wasn't checked properly, you're using the wrong form, all kinds, and then they would send the form and the check back, and then they would realize that they were wrong. No, this was the right form, please resubmit. And so this is the way the DEA are experts in that kind of bureaucratic nonsense. So they'll be able to stagnate this process for quite a while, I think. Go ahead, you got one more? Sure, yeah. Oh, you got to cut it off. All right. Okay, you got it. Thank you all so much. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys.